So, also, when we announce this workshop, I only had a couple of people, but always people turn up. And this is Carl Martel. He's a visiting hemp consultant from Canada, and I'm rapt that he's here. We've had him on the radio already. And it's just great, these connections that happen with Nembin and Weed. And anyway, he's got lots to tell you. Thanks, heaps, Carl.
So let me introduce myself. I have it right here, sorry.
Yeah, cool.
So I'm Canadian. I come from a little town called Ottawa, and been in this industry now for about 7 years. I work with a company called Valley Bio, so we're the largest producers of industrial hemp in Eastern Canada. And from that, so we grow grain, all different kinds of grain actually on the farm. So it's about 1,000 acres. We grow, it's rye, buckwheat, soybeans, all these things. And hemp fits right in there as a great rotational crop. So yeah, you're gonna hear something a little bit different than all this afternoon. You're gonna hear the medical side of things. So I'm really more the food side of things. And so we grow grain for food. And I mean, that's what the majority of Canada actually grows, right? It's hemp, when we talk industrial hemp, 95% of all hemp grown in Canada is for food. So the oils, the grain, the alternative other products, everything else. Now, what I really do is I work the material science side of things and look at taking the waste materials that's left and then converting them into usable products. And over time, I've been able to come up with a bunch of different things. This here, for example, and it might be different for y'all to see, but maybe afterwards you just come by and see what you want. This is what I call geohemp. So it's basically taking that waste stock. So what we're doing in Canada is we grow for grain. Now our grain will grow between 6 and 12 feet tall, right? 12 is a little high though for harvesting. We want ideally between 6 and 8 to grow the bud is. So we're cutting it off basically just underneath there, then we're left with stock about a meter and a half long. Now, at the moment, for the last 15 years, most of that just gets plowed into the ground. Now, that's good. It's good, fertilizer and everything else, great for the soil. But we can be doing a lot more things with it. So what I did was I developed a binder, and it's not lime, and it's not Portland cement, so it's a very ancient binder, actually. My background is actually I'm a geoarchaeologist, and spent a number of years either in Europe or the Middle East doing lots of digs. And then coming back to Canada, and for archaeologists, and I kind of fell into the hemp when I started to work on my house and saying, I don't like all these products that are on the market. This pink insulation, it's just terrible, itchy, terrible. So I gotta develop something else. And that's how I kind of got introduced to it. But anyway, so this hemp that's in here, right, is basically the waste. Okay, so these farmers, before they were gonna plow on the ground, I took it, harvested it and did some things that I learned about decortication and other things like that, and put it into basically a mold that I made with the cements and created this kind of a countertop. So it has it's a mineral binder, right, with minerals in it on the top, and the back end is basically, the rest is all hemp, right? It's the waste hemp with the fiber and the bird in there. And so it makes it somewhat still kind of heavy. It's very, very hard. And thought I would make an ideal type of countertop. So that's what I've been kind of developing there. I was asked though as well, because Canada presses a lot of oil, everything for seed, not everything just goes into basically the seeds are dehulled and then you can buy it as food. In Canada we've been eating hemp for a number of years now, I guess 20 years, and there's no ill side effects, And from that though, right, there was this waste oil, right, that was coming out, right, because we're pressing more and more and more of it, and then there was this expired food grade oil. So I'm saying, well, what can we do with that? So I looked at that and I then developed a stain, right, paints and stains made from expired food grade hemp oil with using natural earth pigments, right. There's no solvents in this, there's no petrochemicals or anything else, it's all natural. I go up to, when I started field testing this, go up to the client in Ottawa, so now on about 150 different decks and fences across Ottawa, and it doesn't peel. And I go up I'll mix it right in front of the client, put my finger in the oil, taste it right there, right? I love that. So it's just expired food grade hemp oil, right? Great for stains. And so that uses up that kind of waste. So that waste stream is now taken care of with that. This now sells for, it's $50 for basically four liters for 1 gallon, right? So we've taken a product that was worth nothing and turned it into something. Now from that, you know, I continue developing other things, working with the hemp oils. Now these are now rancid oils. So this is basically just a clear type of oil that can be used for other industrial purposes. And I went on a little bit further and then developed this is a plastic, liquid plastic. So it's a green replacement for those petrochemical plastics that are made on the market. What makes these sort of plastic bags all made from petrochemicals, your oil that comes from the ground. Well, this can be now done with just a food grade, expired food grade hemp oil. So that's where that comes in from. And it makes different kinds of plastics. Doesn't look like much, but kind of hard.
What's happening?
Different things. And this one here is, it might be a little difficult to see from over there, but it's kind of a cottonized hemp fiber.
I could pass it around?
Sure.
Yeah. And the block?
Which probably...
We'll get to the block.
Sure.
It's pretty interesting.
So that there is just essentially it's the waste material. So this is from a dual-use crop. In the past, it had been suggested that you cannot harvest beautiful white fibers or textile fibers from a dual-use crop because the stock is too mature, too old. You know, about 120, 150 days, well past what usually goes when you grow fiber for fiber, right? The maturity time is a lot lower. You're talking 90 days. So they're saying, you know, you need an immature crop to produce really beautiful fiber as well. So once you see that going past around and say, oh, that seems fine to me, and the rest of the industry kind of agrees that, you know, that would be a very nice quality textile fiber that can make it anywhere. So that there is, again, it's from the waste. So after we harvest the grain, we're left with basically a meter and a half of stock, right? And that stock can then be converted into all kinds of things. So you have that there, textile fiber, right? And then it can also be turned into other things like your hempcrete. We're developing a kind of a new hempcrete as well, where this one here can actually be put right into a cement truck, delivered on site, and poured in the main wall. So this can replace then your drywall, your vapor barrier, your standard pink insulation, your fiberglass, and your exterior. And that would all be right there as a lightweight, hard type of thing. And do you want to pass that on?
This is the amazing bit. It's so light.
It's nice and light. And it's fire resistant, water resistant, these sort of things. You can improve the properties too. You know, you put that, you'll find though, it's not concrete though. You will be able to break it. So I appreciate, you know, not snapping it in half, but if it happens, it happens.
No.
But it's a non-structural material, and all hempcretes are. I mean, you really need to still have that wood frame that's inside, so you have the 2x4s that are spaced everywhere. That becomes your structure. Then with this is, the idea is to put up some forms, okay? And then your cement truck comes along, and it pours right into the wall, and then fills up that gap where the form is. Remove your form, now you have your wall. And it's a breathable type of material. And in combining it with other things like, so you take the lime, so that's basically 65% cellulose or hemp, and then 15% is your binder, which would be lime. Now lime, when you combine it with other things like diatomaceous earth, right, it's an amorphous silica. Now that silica, right, in combination with that, creates a feebly hydraulic kind of lime. Something like the ancients would have used when they were first developing some of their first cements. And one of the nice things about diatomaceous earth when it binds up with lime diatomaceous earth is a known mycotoxin binder. So that just means, you know, that black mold that everybody's so familiar with? Well, by having that in your wall, it'll hold on to that, kill your black mold, you don't have anymore. And because it's a vapor permeable, that bacteria that is carried on your vapor in the air and everything else, caught in that wall, dies, and then your walls kind of act as the lungs of the house, creating a much better environment. And it also maintains a certain level of humidity, because those walls will absorb all that humidity, hold on to it, and then least as things get cold. So in the Canadian environment, that really helps. It gets really, really dry in the wintertime. So in the summertime, like in summer, we get really, really humid. In England, they found that when they built a plant called the Adnan's Brewery, they found that after they built with these panels, that these hempcrete panels that went all the way around, sealed the structure, they've been able to maintain 13 degrees, 50% humidity all year round. And you know it's pretty rainy over in England, right? So it's been able to do a great job that way. So it covers through that whole idea of having a very wholesome environment in your home. That's important. In Canada especially, because we lock up our houses come wintertime. Last week in Ottawa it was minus 30, so degrees Celsius, not Fahrenheit or anything, so it was pretty cold. And structures like that, so when we close things up, that air in the house, right, can be fairly sterile, or not sterile, but stagnant, right, need to circulate it in other ways and things like that. And so by having warming systems like this, it can improve our insulation of the house, allows for the permeability of fresh air to kind of interact with the room that you're in, and maintains decent humidity levels. So when it's really, really dry, you can be really dried out and everything else. So that's kind of nice, having something like that. Eventually, the industry in Canada, when it comes to fiber, though, is still a little behind. We're reaching a level of maturity where grain, where we're harvesting lost grain. We did about 100,000 acres last year in Canada for grain. And now the industry is saying, well, what are we going to do with all this other material? And this is what probably one of the next things is developing those waste fibers and turning them into building materials, the hempcrete and other things like that. So there's that. There's a whole range of things that can really be done. I mean, talking about, I heard the doctor earlier talking about, the food's really important, and the hemp seed. These are things that we're doing in Canada. The idea behind, as well, having a plant that we can do all these different things with. We're in development right now as well that we can actually have, right now we're harvesting for seed, and we can do something with fiber. Legislation at the moment doesn't permit us to use the flower or the leaf. Now that's going to change under the new government, probably in the foreseeable next couple of years, hopefully. Now, what companies like Valley Bio, who I work with, are in the process of doing. Like we own seed genetics, we develop seed, we put a lot of research into developing new seeds. What's coming down the line, for example, what might be most pertinent here, is that developing a crop that can have high CBD levels and low THCs, and the government will say, fine, go ahead. And so that's what's probably coming down next. So you'll have now a plant that you'll have your food from, you can harvest your medicine from, and your textiles for clothing and building materials. So that would probably be what's coming down right now. Right now, what's in the field for hemp, industrial hemp, we're looking at about 2% CBD, right, and under 1% THC. So in the future, there's gonna be this kind of a hybridization of materials where you get, your food, medicine, and fiber all from that. And so I don't know if, what else I might kind of say? I can open myself up to some questions if that's fine with everybody. If you have some questions, go right ahead.
Hey. Is it legal to have medical cannabis in Canada?
Sorry, say again?
Is it legal to have medical cannabis in Canada?
Yes and no. It's kind of going through kind of a growth spurt at the moment. So with this new government, one of the reasons why Trudeau got elected was that he suggested legalization of recreational use of marijuana. We've had medical cannabis allowed to us since 1998. But there is some resistance because doctors are sitting there going, well, what's the dose that I'm supposed to, give this to people? So that's kind of slowed things down a bit because a lot more research has to go into this and developing and understanding that whole plant a lot better. So it's there in some parts of Canada. Yeah, it's very easy to get. Vancouver, there's lots of dispensaries. They have like 200 right in that region there. But in the rest of Canada, it's a little touch and go. Some doctors will say yes, we'll prescribe it. Other doctors will say no. But you can get it anywhere in Canada. Canada, and now too, the Supreme Court last year said that they could allow the use of all the plant, right? So you can use them now, don't have to just smoke it. Before, people who were using cannabis had to smoke actually the marijuana because of the way the legislation was written. It was challenged and said, yeah, now people, you can now eat it and do all these other things with it. Also, there was some kind of discussion going on whether big business should control it or, you know, the regular person should control it. So now, Supreme Court, just recently, I think this was last week, they actually said, no, federal government now has 1 year to change this legislation that they had in place before, saying that the individual person could not grow. They now have the right to grow. So, and I think now it's gonna be a question of numbers, how many can you grow and whatnot. So, for medicinal uses, because that's how it actually started. They said that, you know, anybody that has actually something from the doctor for medicinal use, you could actually grow your own, you had another plant. And then the conservative government came in and said, no, we're gonna put that now into the hands of the companies, and they're gonna grow it and sell it to you. So that lasted a few years, and now, yeah, the government's come back and said, or the courts have come back and said, no, Canadians have a right to grow their own. So the little, you know, just the regular person will be able to grow it, and you'll also have probably the big dispensaries or the big companies that are actually growing as well. And it's there's some pros and cons to this. I mean, one of the reasons why I like some of the big companies doing this is that they're now gonna have the money. They're the ones that have gone forward and said, this is what's in our plant. You know, they're able to do the testing. The person growing that plant at home, right, might have the ability to grow it, but not have any way of testing what they're actually taking in. So that's where these kind of big companies have stepped in and said, well, with our product, this is the percentage of THC, this is the percentage of CBDs, and so on and so forth. And I think they'll kind of go hand in hand for quite a while, which is good, because you'll have some stimulation going on one side, and then you'll also have big industry on the other. But generally, the big industry is not so much big pharma yet. I mean, big pharma might be saying, oh, there might be a company there. But these are just individual people that started up a small business, and then away they went. So they're, you know, growing a couple hundred plants, you know, and then sending that out. And that's in conjunction with your doctor and the government, everybody kind of making that all the way.
Okay, thanks very much.
And
Lizard, I'm
interested in hemp as a building material. So I live in the white ant capital of the world, so just wondering, is it white ant resistant at all? Sorry. As a building material?
Is it?
Termites.
White ants.
Termites? Yeah. No. I don't believe so. I mean, more testing have to be done, and I think there's probably been lots of tests done with the hempcrete here in New South Wales. In Canada, in general, insects don't like it. One, diatomaceous earth is what can actually be used as an insecticide. And that being in the walls and whatnot, insects won't generally like it. It cuts their feet and everything else, right? So in some sense then, it should have these anti-insectual insect properties to it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that would be in theory. We really have to test it out and see. But I think sometimes we've already just done that.
And just one other question. When you're talking about pouring it, you're talking about pouring it between two layers of the, like the panel stuff, is that what you mean?
Yeah, so yeah. You would basically, you know, when you pour your foundation, there's usually some forms, structural forms, pieces of wood on both sides, hold the cement in place, and that's, then they're just pouring the cement right in from a cement truck. The same principles I'm trying to apply to the hempcrete, so that you'd have your structure. So after your foundation is built, right, made out of concrete or whatever, right, then you have your floor put down. Then they're going to build basically your 2x4 wall. Then on the other side of that, you'll have two forms, just like the concrete. Two forms there, the truck comes in, pours right in, right? 24 hours later, you remove the form, okay? Now you still have the structural numbers in place, right? And then you can just go on to build your second floor, and so on and so forth, the next set of walls, and then the truck comes back and fills it up. So that's how it's kind of meant to work that way. So, and then you can seal the exterior, for example, with one of these hemp oil based type of oils, because the oils in contact with the lime as well will create kind of soap, and then that will seal in all the cracks and create a kind of a waterproof surface. So, and you can color it in different things and everything else.
Okay, thanks very much. And of course, YouTube is full of recipes on that. And here's another question.
Hello, Carl.
Hi.
I happen to have a bit of hemp laying around, and I was wondering, your recipe, is it proprietary? Can you buy it in Australia, or is it something you can tell us homemade?
At the moment, yeah, it's still proprietary, so I'm under non-disclosure agreements with certain individuals here. And so, yeah, everything at the moment is somewhat proprietary. And, you know, I'm here as well from a food safety perspective and implementing certain Canadian standards, if you want, on the industry. So I'm kind of working on that side too. So this is kind of the side, and how I was right here to treat business meetings and that way as a consultant. So yeah, some of the things that I'm talking about are under non-disclosure, so I have to be somewhat careful with what I say. But I'm sure in time it will become readily available and all that.
Okay, and here's a little idea for your termite problem. If you mix a bit of biochar in with the hemp, it's been proven to stop scaffolding. They can't actually use their enzymes to break down.
And it also increases the R value of the wall.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
One more question.
Hi, Carl. I've had a debate over the years with a friend in the UK who I once went to school with, who did his PhD on paper making with hemp, and has since gone into a career working for European paper mills. And he has continuously said that making paper for the market is difficult with hemp because you can't get the white, paper. Well, on further investigation and more discussion, I did learn that that the cost of changing paper mills from
wood
from the wood and the industry is prohibitive. So, can you just talk to that?
Yes. Well, coming from Canada, and we have lots of trees. That's one of our main kind of, I guess, industries that we have there. Yes, it is somewhat, the way things are set up at the moment, I think there would be a strong lobby because people would be afraid of their jobs and other things like that. But some of these things are actually suggested. I don't think that's necessarily true. I mean, you saw the fiber, that fiber is white. It's very, very white, and it shouldn't be a problem. One of the reasons why it does go yellow is because of lignin, right? That's associated with the plant. If you remove the lignin though, and that's what they're trying to do with wood pulp, right? The difference though between hemp and wood, for example, there's a couple of things. One, hemp will grow four times more biomass than a forest will, you know, a regular tree forest. So it makes a lot more sense actually doing it with hemp, but the industry's not quite there. And I don't think we could actually replace all the paper that we use on the planet by using hemp. You know, that might be a small part, but until we actually start growing it for something like that, it takes some time. I mean, it could be an input. The next thing is, the real difference though between hemp and wood, and I was talking about that lignin. Wood pulp has somewhere in the neighborhood of 27 to 35% lignin, so it's a lot of glue is holding that wood together. With hemp, we're only dealing with about 6 to 9%, so it's a lot easier to extract, right? So this argument that, you know, you can't actually get it white or you can't remove the lignin is obviously a fallacy. I mean, I think you held that up and you see it yourself. All the lignin's been removed from that, so it won't go yellow. Well, the reason why the paper goes yellow is because of the residual lignin that's left in, but also and removing lignin can be a very difficult process. And when you're talking about concentrations of upwards of 35%, like in wood, that's why they have to use very caustic type of things. And I don't know if you've ever been close to a pulp mill, but you have that kind of a sulfur smell that kind of goes on with it. And that's all part of the pulping process, right? Where they have to use some chlorine dioxide or all kinds of other stuff, nasty stuff that they go in with it. This here, this process here is a very environmentally friendly process. I mean, the byproduct at the end of its life can be taken and actually poured right onto your farmer's field. So it acts as a fertilizer or they can be used onto dirt roads for dust suppressants instead of using calcium chloride. So because the lignin that's in there, so it's just lignin and water when you go. So,
just as a closing comment, I know the Declaration of Independence in America was written on hemp paper,
yep.
And the Mona Lisa was painted on hemp
canvas. That's right.
Which is pretty common standard. And I know, just changing the subject, one of these young gentlemen here asked me before, and you haven't mentioned it, but it's worth asking. Do you know anything about hemp biofuels? Anyone in that industry and something? Yeah, you've got a comment.
Well, yeah, they have been kind of investigating that. I mean, you can have cellulosic ethanol, for example, that can be actually taken from some of the products that I'm actually doing. This can actually then be converted into bioethanol. So that would be cellulosic ethanol, because hemp is, you know, somewhere maybe about 70% cellulose. And it's second only to cotton, except the beauty of hemp and cotton is that, well, we can't grow cotton in Canada, it's too cold. But we can grow lots and lots of hemp. And it doesn't use anywhere near pesticides or herbicides that cotton uses. And from what I heard last was cotton uses something like 25% of all herbicides and pesticides on the planet. 25%, that's a quarter of all herbicides and pesticides goes into growing. And water, yeah, lots and lots of water. The hemp grows great in very dry conditions, so and it doesn't use any pesticides and herbicides. Well, it's a weed, so why don't you want to put anything else on there? And if it's, when it's grown with other plants as well, you can control those weeds, so and allowing it then to actually grow and propagate in a very reasonable way without using any of those harsh chemicals. Does that answer your question, or? Is that good? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you. Let's hope that you're going to be back here in Australia. He likes Newman.
I love
it. Yeah. So it'd be lovely to have you here at Mardi Gras or talking again. Or you're around for a month?
Yeah.
Maybe around?
Yeah, I'll be about another 3 weeks, 3 or 4 weeks here. And then I think the government of Canada wants me back and a few companies, so.
Really appreciate you being here today. Okay, now it's 4:20. See how we are so accurate. We start exactly and finish spot on. But in fact, I've got more. If you can handle it, I've got more. Ash, he has got an announcement, which is short. But then I've got Radic, and we're going to do a cold extraction. It's one thing to talk about it forever. It's another thing to actually see it physically happen. So we've done this before, so anyone who wants to hang around, we'll just do an example of how to do a cold extraction and get the medicine out of cannabis using ethanol. We'll do that here. Any undercovers present, we'd like them to come forward straight away and just, you know, no. Here's Ash.
Thanks, Michael. I want to thank everyone for coming and supporting the Hemp Embassy. It's got to start somewhere, we'll start here, it's not going to start anywhere else. I'm actually a trustee of an educational non-profit foundation. We've got 6,000 on record and 44 medical records with alternative treatments, which we collect medical records to educate the public. Everyone here today is here to get a program, let's face it, because we can talk about science all day, but what you really need is stuff to take home and do that, and we give you the program free. We've done everything from stage 4 metastatic prostate to bone to...